Good morning. Welcome to worship. Very glad to have all of you here with us today. Special welcome to our guests and visitors who are joining us from near and far. We are so glad to have you. If it's your first time back with us in a while, welcome in the name of Christ. We are so glad that you are here with us as well. As you can imagine, we have several announcements today. However, we will move those to the end. Many things before us, exciting and wonderful things, so we will focus on those first, and at the end of our time together, we'll have some announcements. We make our beginning today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Christ is risen and ascended.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said, I tell you the truth, unless a man is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. The holy apostles of the Lord have written, the promise is for you and your children, and baptism now saves you. Receive the sign of the cross on your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Now, sponsors, after Anne has been baptized, it is your duty and your privilege as sponsors as well as parents to remember her always in your prayers, put her in mind of her baptism, give your counsel and aid that she be brought up in the true knowledge and worship of God, be taught the Ten Commandments, the Creed, the Lord's Prayer, and as she grows in years, you place into her hands the Holy Scriptures. Bring her to the services of God's house and provide for her further instruction in the Christian faith, that she come to the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, and thus abiding in her baptismal grace and in communion with the church, she may grow up to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of Jesus Christ. In other words, when she sees you, sponsors, mom and dad, she sees men and women of faith, people that she can look to, not only for words of advice, but also an example of life. It is a tremendous responsibility. After hearing all these things, do you promise to fulfill these obligations? If so, then say yes with the help of God. God enable you to do this faithful and loving work, and with his grace fulfill what we are otherwise unable to do. Now, because Anne cannot answer for herself, we shall together, along with the sponsors and parents, faithfully speak on her behalf in testimony of the forgiveness of sins and the birth of faith and life which God our Father bestows in and through the waters of holy baptism. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus and to confess the faith of the church into which we baptize. Do you renounce the devil and all of his wicked works and all of his wicked ways?
I do renounce them.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth?
Yes. Yes.
God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes. Yes, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of our body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Will she get handed off?
Yes.
All right. Oh, look how precious you are. Anne, Joyce, Leah, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Peace be with you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Let me hand you back to Dad here. Wonderful. All right. So we have some things for you. Receive this white cloth to show that Christ has taken away Anne's sins. Let me give that to you, Nadia. If you'd be so kind as to light this candle for me. Yeah, right off there. Perfect. Excellent. Receive this burning light as a symbol of the living light that now lives within Anne's heart. Let's join together in a word of prayer. Lord and giver of life, look with kindness upon Thomas and Rachel and upon all our parents. Let them ever rejoice in the gift you have given them. Enable them to be teachers and examples of righteousness for their children. Strengthen them in their own baptisms so that they may share eternally with their children the salvation you have given to them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Through baptism, God has added Anne to his own people to declare the wonderful deeds of our Savior, who called us out of the depths of darkness and into his marvelous light. We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as a fellow member of the body of Christ, a child of the same heavenly Father, to work with us in his kingdom. And you, Anne, the Lord bless you in all of your ways from this time forward and forevermore. Amen. Let's welcome Anne to the community of faith.
Thank you.
rise. Though Christ is ascended on high and is seated at the right hand of the Father, ruling and reigning over all creation, there have been times where we have lived as though we rule and reign over our own lives. We have lived as though Christ were too far away to remember or to matter. But our Heavenly Father invites us to return to Him, confess our sins, and to receive His forgiveness. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die and rise for you. Christ is ascended, and all things are under His feet, including sin, death, and the devil. On account of Christ's saving work and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Pray. Lord Jesus, you ascended to the right hand of the Father, and there you rule over the whole universe for our good. Keep our focus on you, so that we may find peace in you alone, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our epistle lesson for today comes from Ephesians, the first chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and a revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your heart enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which you have been called, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. Then he blessed them, he parted from them, and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple, blessing God. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to be seated, and I apologize for my allergies. 'Tis the season for those. We continue with our next hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Saying goodbye is an incredibly difficult thing, especially when it's someone you love, someone you care about, someone who has touched your life tremendously. In all of our lives, we have had to say goodbye to these very people. And it is this dynamic of saying goodbye, but also with Christ also remaining with us, that we find in our gospel lesson appointed for today. And we begin our lesson in verses 50 and 51. Here Luke writes, "And he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. But why did he ascend today anyways? After all, his disciples had all types of things that they wanted him to do. They had a to-do list a mile long for him to complete the work that they believed he needed to complete. We read this in Acts. Now, Luke and Acts, written by the same author, Luke focuses in on the ministry of Jesus. Acts focuses in on the early church, Acts of the Apostles. That's why it's called that. Same author, two different purposes, but one gospel. And we find in our gospel lesson for today, as well as Acts 1, there's a little bit of an overlap. Sort of a slosh over from one book to the other to get everyone on the same page. And we find in Acts chapter 1, verse 6, that the disciples had a definite vision of what they wanted Jesus to do. They said, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" That was their ultimate dream. Their ultimate dream was to make Israel the center of the entire world. Religiously, politically, economically, culturally, and at the head of it would be the Messiah. This was the dream of Jewish people at the time of Jesus, that this Messiah would come and make Israel the epicenter, would make Israel powerful and strong and faithful again. So Jesus had died and he had risen. And they said to him, "So are you going to do this thing that we want you to do yet?" But the fact is, not only was he not going to do that, but he had his own checklist that was taken care of. There was him going to the cross, suffering and dying for each and every one of your sins, every sin that has been committed, every sin that will be committed in your lifetime and in the lifetime of every person. All that is washed away in the blood that he shed on the cross for you. Check. He rose from the dead, conquering death. Death cannot hold him. And because he lives, we live in him as well. Check that one off the list as well. And then there was the issue of him needing to make himself known. And he did that as well. He appeared to all the people that needed to see him, sometimes over multiple occasions over these 40 days. We find that he appeared to the disciples with Thomas and without Thomas. He appeared to the women at the tomb, the men on the road to Emmaus. There was that fishing trip. It's fishing opener this weekend. The disciples were out fishing, and Peter ended up jumping in, swimming to shore because he was so excited to see Jesus. And we read even in 1 Corinthians 15, 6, that he appeared at once to 500 people. Now, COVID has really done a number on my perception of numbers. I don't even know what a crowd of 500 people looks like, especially close together. So I searched online. This is some random UN conference that happened in Spain. I don't even know what it was about, but there's 500 people all gathered together. That's a lot of people. And according to Paul's letter to the Corinthian church, 500 of them saw Jesus at one time. So it's safe to say that Jesus appeared to everyone that needed to know that he was alive, sometimes several times over a period of 40 days. But as we read about him ascending into heaven, the question we ask ourselves here today is, what does this mean for me? How is this more than just an informational story about how Jesus got from point A to point B? What does this actually mean for me? When somebody leaves, oftentimes we find that that is the end of a relationship. In my life, growing up, even into the present time, about every 5 years, it seems, I pick up and move to a whole different place, sometimes more, sometimes less. And I think about many of those relationships that I developed over those times. And sure, maybe one or two or three endure. But for the most part, everyone recognizes that when you say goodbye, when you close the door on the car, when you wave from the gate of the airport, that that's going to be the end of your relationship with that person, or at least in any substantive way. And when somebody has left you, especially someone important, there is that concern that we're just being left alone. We're being left in the dust, forgotten about. Well, this other person moves on with their new life. And maybe that's how we feel. Jesus went up into heaven, and we're kind of here to fend for ourselves. But as we look at this passage, as we look especially at the passages of the New Testament, we find that that is simply not the case. We find that God cares for us while we wait. He cares for us in this waiting space. One of the ways that he cares for his people then as well as now is by opening their minds to understand the Word of God. Here's what we read in verse 45. Then he opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. Whenever we read the Bible through the eyes of faith, suddenly things start to move into place. What he did for the disciples at this time was help them to understand the breadth of this story, all the way from the beginning in the Old Testament to his ministry, and also fresh purpose for what lay ahead. All those tumblers in the lock started to line up appropriately. And the same is true for us. When we read the Scriptures with the eyes of faith, they're open to us. So we understand not only the great story that God is telling us, but we see our place in the story as well. And then we find in just a few days' time, there is Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit came. Jesus left, but the Holy Spirit came to the disciples and to the church. They were not left alone. They were not abandoned, but they were cared for as they awaited his return. And this is the same care that he gives to us today. But that's not all. We find that also God gives us real spiritual food and communion, where in, with, and under this bread and wine is the very body and blood of Jesus. Yes, Jesus ascended into heaven today, but he still comes to us in the present day in communion. He is with us. And where he is, we are never truly alone. God arranges then, through word and through sacrament, to care for us, his people, during this waiting time. Which is why our time, gathering together, is so important. It satisfies our deepest spiritual hunger. Because if we are not fed through word and through sacrament, we find that we get hungry. Hunger leads to weakness. Weakness leads to sickness. Sickness eventually leads to spiritual death. So Ascension Day, it's all the more a reason for us to seek out those ways that God has given to us for us to be fed, because we need strength for the weight that lies ahead. In Acts 1, we find that Jesus was taken away and eventually hidden from their sight behind a cloud. And I always thought to myself, okay, Jesus hid behind a cloud, kind of like a curtain going closed on a stage. But then I started looking more into Scripture and the importance that clouds played in the life of God's people. When the people left Egypt, what led them by day? A pillar of cloud. Mount Sinai, storms, Moses, Ten Commandments. What was covering that? It was a cloud. The Transfiguration, what covered them when God spoke? Yes, again, it is a cloud. When the temple was dedicated, it was filled with smoke. Another word for a cloud. We see that God's presence is related to clouds. So that when Jesus was hidden by a cloud, what God was saying in that moment was, he's coming back to me. He's coming back to my presence. But what exactly is he doing up in heaven? What is he doing up there? As I was putting together this slideshow deck, I showed this picture to our administrative assistant, Chris, and she said to me, he looks so angry and cross in that picture. It's like, what did you do to him? And I'm like, no, he's just very serious. He's very serious about you. He's very serious about the work that he came to do. That is a look of victory, of pure confidence that he is with God in heaven. But what is he doing there in heaven? Well, he's talking about you with God. Jesus is talking about you with God. Now, nobody, and I mean nobody, likes to be talked about, especially when you're not there. Maybe when you were growing up, you had those instances where other kids talked about you, teased you behind your back. Maybe you had those moments where somebody said your name, and across a din of a party, you could hear your name, and you immediately said, "Who's talking about me? I heard my name." Maybe when we think of someone talking about us, we kind of get this image. I don't know what they're talking about, but we can kind of imagine that it's kind of a gossiping thing. Can you believe that person? I know, right? There they go again. Yep. It's kind of, that's what we think about when someone talks about us. But what we find is that God talks about us and Jesus talks about us in heaven, and that is a good thing. We read these words in Romans chapter 8, verses 33 and 34. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. An intercessor is one that stands between us and another person, advocating and speaking on our behalf. When God demands perfection, which he does every minute of every day, there is Jesus as our intercessor. When God sees the deficiency of our life, the sins that we have that have accumulated and continue to accumulate, there is Jesus as our intercessor. Now, this is a little bit of a tangent, but it's really not. When Jesus was taken up into heaven, all of him was taken up into heaven. It's not as if a cloud hid him and they heard a great pop and his body just kind of floated down like a busted balloon. No, all of Jesus was taken up into heaven, including his wounded hands, including his wounded side. And there is Jesus as our intercessor with his wounds visible. So when God demands perfection, which he does, when he looks at our sin, which he knows, there is Jesus saying, I took those sins. Here are my wounds. I took them for this person. When he demands perfection, there is Jesus saying, I have been perfect, and my perfection is now their perfection. Jesus is our intercessor. They are talking about us, and that is a beautiful thing to have someone so great next to our Father in heaven speaking about us, interceding on our behalf. So that's what Jesus is doing. What about us? What are we doing in this waiting space? What do you do? Question for y'all. What do you do when you have a few minutes before you pick up the kids from school? What do you do when you have a few minutes before the doctor finally decides to show up to your appointment? What do you do when you have a few minutes to wait before you get your taxes done? What do? If you're of a certain age, you pull out one of these, right? You look at your text messages, desperately hoping someone will text you. No one texts me, and that's okay, but you still check. Oh, maybe someone wanted to talk to me today. Maybe you go on some sort of mindless game that you play. Maybe you check the news or check social media for the latest depressing news or how fun everyone else's life is in comparison to yours. We sometimes say that we kill time as we're waiting for something. Now, maybe you've used that phrase as well. We kill time. And what does that phrase actually mean to us? It means that we wish that this time was not there at all. We wish that this time was gone so that something more important can come down the pike. Maybe you've killed time. Most of us have in our lives. But none of us would take our entire life and kill time just waiting to die. None of us would say, well, I'm just waiting to die. I'm just kind of twiddling my thumbs, just kind of killing time until eventually I die. None of us would do that. Now, sure, we have known people who have done that through destructive decisions or destructive circumstances. But it's not something that someone intentionally tries to do. But yet I fear, when it comes to our lives of faith, that is precisely what many of us choose to do. If being a Christian is only completely focused in on the end, on what happens when we die, and has nothing to do with our present, then you are spiritually killing time until you die. If someone asks you what it means to be a Christian, and you only go to the immediate end and say, well, that means when I die, I get to go to heaven, then chances are you're spiritually killing time and not living a spiritual life today. Now, before we go any further, let me say this. Yes, absolutely, our faith points us to eternal life with Jesus. We have been purchased and won by his blood on the cross. It doesn't just point us to the end, though. This reality points us to the present and how we live our lives now. So the question remains, though, how do we live our lives in this waiting space as we prepare for Jesus to return? What do? Because we know that Jesus is coming. We read this in Acts chapter 1, verse 11. We see that the angels, in all likelihood, said this: this same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. So what do we do? What do we do as we wait? How do we not spiritually kill time, knowing what the end holds for us and not doing anything else in between now and that end point? Well, I'd like to share with you a little bit about how these first disciples lived during this time. And we look at verses 52 and 53. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple blessing God. These words talk about their inner focus, how they focus their lives looking at God's word, receiving his gifts. Likely communion was a part of that as well. It is an inner focus as we appreciate and live the life that God has given to us. But there is something else that we read. We find it in verse 47. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. That was their outward focus. It's what moved them out to share this good news with other people. And that's our call as believers, to not kill time, but to wisely use the time we have been given, where we live, how we live, and with whom we live. We are called to gather together and inwardly focus in on our faith, to wrestle with God's word, to receive his gifts, to share the strength that we have with one another. That's an inner focus. But yet we are so filled with joy in who we are as God's children, and so filled with genuine, deep sadness that there are those who don't know these things, that there are those who don't have this hope, that we are pushed outward. And as we are pushed outward, we need that strength. We need to be refreshed. We need to be revived. And that moves us inner to the community of faith, to the study of God's word, and it pushes us out. It's a constant cycle, and that is how these early disciples lived in this waiting space. Maybe you've had to say goodbye to somebody very important, someone who shaped your life, someone who molded your life, whose absence is still felt today. As many of you know, I was quite close to my grandfather, and when he passed away, of course, there was that grief. And I remember I was driving one day, and I was filled with a little bit of sadness. It just kind of came on me. And I said, I really wish my grandpa was here. I wish I could have a talk with him. I really wish that my kids could know my politically incorrect grandpa like I knew him. But I knew that wasn't the case. that we'd see each other again, but that is another time for another day. Maybe you've had to say goodbye to someone whose absence is still felt. The disciples said goodbye to Jesus, but yet unlike any other relationship that we've had to say goodbye to permanently, Jesus continues to come to us. He comes to us in his word. He comes to us in communion. He gives us purpose in how we live our lives during this waiting time, to move inward to his word, to this community that we have together, but also to move outward, to share it with others. And having this cycle, having this life that we lead, we use our time wisely as we recognize whose we are in Christ, what we are to do in Christ, and the hope that we have even as we await his return in Christ. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard our hearts and minds until life everlasting. Amen. Having heard God's word, we now rise as we confess the faith that we share with one another in the words of the Nicene Creed. And together we confess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, and of all things were made, who for us stand, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us and on us Pilate. He suffered and buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again in glory and judge all the living and dead, whose kingdom will have not come. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As our offering is brought forward, we continually lift up these gifts, but a small portion of what God has given to us for the growth of his kingdom, for the growth of his people, and ultimately, as in all things, to his glory. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all of those according to their needs. Ascended Lord Jesus Christ, to you belongs the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Confidently we bring our prayers to your throne of grace, knowing that you will respond in whatever way is best for us and in accord with your plan. Lord, in your mercy, as we commemorate this day, your ascension, we pray that we would be proclaimers of the good news of your triumph over sin, death, and the devil, confidently directing people towards your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, our prayer. Almighty Lord, as students in high school and in colleges prepare to graduate over the next many weeks, we ask that you would give them wisdom and guidance in the next few months that lie ahead. For those who look for employment, give to them employment. For those who are preparing for the next stage in life, the next class, the next university, we ask that you would give them safety and allow them to be with people who give them positive examples and positive choices. For those who continue, whether it be in elementary school, high school, or college, we ask that you would give to these students over the summer safety. Give to them what they need in their body from shelter and food, and also to guidance. Father, help us as a community to support students who have been through so much over the past 2 years. We thank you for the continued ministry and presence of teachers in Lutheran schools, high schools, and universities, as well as your people all around the world who teach, who mentor, who educate. Lord, in your mercy, in prayer. On this day of rejoicing, we pray for those with special needs, whose earthly journeys are challenging or painful. Touch them with your limitless power. We ask that you would be with the sick, those who are shut in and whose mobility is not what it once was, and also for those who find themselves distant in many different ways. Lord, we also lift up those that we hold in our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated. And now may this, the true body and the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting, depart in his peace. Amen. We go now with this blessing. Before we do that, just a few announcements. So first off, Vacation Bible School is coming up. We are registering for that now, so your weekly email will have a registration link. So 3-year-old, potty trained, all the way up to 6th grade. So a wide range. It's a really innovative program. We really look forward to having your family or your relatives join us for that. Donations, we need donations, and there's lists out there of ways that you can help that. Also, I believe it's next week, we have our voters meeting. Packets are out there. So if you want to look at what the business of the church is, we would encourage you to take a look at that. And finally, as many of you probably were surprised like I was with the mask mandate, what does this mean? Do we keep our masks on? Do we keep them off? So just very, very briefly, as it stands right now, we will maintain having our masking and distancing this week, obviously, and next week. Come June, some things are going to be changing. Our services are going to be moving into the sanctuary. Some of those distancing things will be going away. We are adding a Monday evening service in that usual spot. And that Monday evening, we will be maintaining some of those distancing protocols because we want to make sure, ultimately, that everyone can hear the gospel, that everyone can receive the sacraments. We also want to let you all know that for those who are not comfortable being in a full service, we are having our small group communion time on Tuesday in the evening. So we make that available to those who just don't quite feel comfortable. I think the big thing moving forward is that we understand that everyone is at a different place. That announcement might have been, all right, about time for some of you. For others, it might be, I'm not sure how I feel about that. We want to respect consciences and ultimately make St. John's a place where everyone of all different conscience levels, when it comes to these masks and whatnot, can come and worship, can come and be fed. What ties us together is our hope of in Christ Jesus, not what divides us. That's out there. So if you have any questions, we will be giving you more information in our communications coming up. So, and if you have any other questions, talk to myself, talk to Pastor Snow, call the church office. It's continuing to evolve as things have changed quite rapidly over the past few weeks. But we are listening, and we're trying to make this a place where everyone can come and worship. We go now with this blessing in this place of waiting. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Thank you.